Friday, Baylor family, and welcome to Lariat TV News Today. I'm Sarah Gill.
And I'm Grace Smith, bringing you this week's newscast from outside the studio to adhere to social distancing guidelines.
And this week's newscast will give you the latest on the investigation of a murder that happened just off campus. Recap Monday's gas leak emergency and hear from football coach Dave Aranda.
All this and more on Lariat TV News Today. Let's get started.
What was originally thought to be a suicide in a home near campus has now turned into a murder investigation. Waco police say when officers arrived on the scene at 312 Wagon Wheel early in the morning last Friday, they found a 21-year-old man dead in his bedroom. He had a single gunshot wound to the head. Officer Garen Bynum of the Waco Police Department told us that students should not be worried.
It was absolutely a targeted incident. It was not a random act of violence. It was a targeted incident that involved drug activity and things of that nature.
Tuesday's presidential debate is trending on social media. The event was filled with playground insults and a lack of political etiquette. And LTVN's Madison Martin spoke with students about their thoughts and opinions on the event.
President Trump and former Vice President Joe Biden appeared on stage in Cleveland, Ohio for the first United States presidential debate this year. Instead of illuminating democracy in a civilized discussion, both candidates exchanged insults marked by interruptions and failed to address important topics. Students share their thoughts and opinions on both candidates in the presidential debate.
Both should have allowed each other more time to elaborate on their opinions. I feel like neither of them really got their points across because they were too busy like overlapping on each other, and we didn't really get like a clear and concise answer about a lot of things that needed to be addressed.
One of the many issues the states are facing is remaining united as people become more socially, economically, and politically divided.
I think everyone just wants peace and just like to stop fighting. Americans just want to be whole again and not have to feel this, you know, divide.
After the debate revealed the political etiquette and maturity of both candidates, people feel it's a sign for American citizens to do their part and make the changes they want to see.
At the moment, it really comes up, rather than just relying on the president, it becomes a responsibility of the people, and it requires them to be more involved and politically active.
The presidential debate left most students with unanswered questions and disappointment in both candidates that are soon to be chosen to lead the country. Students hope to see more changes in the right direction to aid them in their decision-making for the best person to be in office. For Lariat TV News, I'm Madison Martin.
Masks off seemed to be a popular theme at the first home football game last Saturday against Kansas.
Fans were seen without face coverings and not properly social distancing. I spoke with both county health authorities and school administrators who view this as a learning opportunity, developing new strategies for the next home game in 2 weeks.
Sick 'em Bears. Let's see your Baylor mask.
Let's see those Baylor masks might have been said a few too many times at Baylor's first football game last Saturday against Kansas, as many fans were caught not wearing masks or socially distancing during the game.
I think it's one of those things that obviously people are taking snapshots and big pictures to frankly prove the point that they want made. But you look at some of the pictures and it would make it appear that no students were wearing face coverings at the game, and that's certainly not the case.
Prior to the game, Baylor Athletics sent out McLean Stadium's mandatory safety procedures, including wearing a face mask at all times except when seated or actively eating or drinking, and socially distancing between parties was mandatory at all times.
It's an educational opportunity for us, but the good thing is that we have 2 weeks to look at these lessons learned. We can look at what went well, what didn't go well, and develop our strategies in time for the Oklahoma State game October 17th.
Show everyone what Baylor can do.
For Lariat TV News, I'm Grace Smith.
Bluetooth bracelets, a key piece of technology implemented at the Baylor game, were given to those running the line. They were designed to help students keep social distancing, letting them know when they might be too close to a fellow student.
We did initiate for the Baylor line bracelets that each person wore. And what that allowed us to do is to do some contact tracing. If someone did come in contact with someone who has COVID-19, to determine if that was a close contact with them. For the first game, the first time we've done something of that nature, we would consider it a success.
Tuesday, there will be 600 students randomly chosen to be COVID tested from the 2,500 who attended the game.
We're going to let the data drive any decisions or any characterizations that we would have for the game at this stage.
The latest data shows that 15 students tested positive on Monday following the football game on Saturday. This is the highest number of cases in a single day in more than 2 weeks on the Baylor campus.
The COVID dashboard is still being updated daily. As of Thursday, the Baylor community has officially passed the 1,000 case mark. Up next, we'll look at two Baylor professors who are helping develop a COVID-19 vaccine. They plan to release this before the end of next semester.
We'll also hear from two sworn soccer player enemies who now play side by side wearing green and gold. Keep it right here.
At Baylor, our lights shine
while we push our limits
and guide the way.
At Baylor, our lights shine
as we're making connections
and making an impression
as leaders
and as part of something bigger.
Baylor's light shines around the world, but it starts in each of us. Baylor, where lights shine bright.
Due to the ongoing pandemic, protecting students against respiratory illnesses like the flu this season is now more important than ever. Though flu season differs from year to year, studies show getting the flu shot can reduce the severity of the illness and lessen your chances of hospitalization. These are critical considerations when the healthcare system is now flooded with coronavirus cases. Baylor Medical Director Dr. Sharon Stern tells us the benefits of the flu vaccination and encourages students to get their flu shot during the outbreak of COVID-19.
There are always hospitalizations from the flu every year. If we have an uptick in that, and then we have our COVID patients also increasing, that can overwhelm the capacity of hospitals. We have to follow the guidelines.
With the hope for a light at the end of the COVID-19 tunnel across the world, two Baylor professors have taken up the ultimate challenge, developing their own vaccine. Doctors Peter Hotez and Maria Elena Batazzi are dean and assistant dean for the school within Baylor's College of Medicine, and they're the only professors from the college who teach on campus in Waco. In conjunction with Biological E, the vaccine they're developing will start testing next month, with advanced trials hopefully starting in January. Dr. Bertazzi said they hope the vaccine will be licensed for distribution in late summer or early fall of next year.
In order to remain socially distant in a typically crowded area, Moody Memorial Library has implemented a tracking device on a first floor monitor to show available seating throughout the building. Using OcuSpace sensors, Baylor can determine how many people are in one given area with Bluetooth and Wi-Fi signals on laptops, cell phones, and other devices. Dean of Libraries Jeffrey Archer says this technology, at a relatively low cost, provides students with a helpful idea on where the safest places to study would be at any given time in Moody Library.
There were some anxious moments on campus Monday morning after students got an email alert about a construction accident near the 8th Street parking garage. LTVN's George Schroeder was on the scene shortly after news broke.
Baylor students were evacuated from common grounds and immediate surrounding buildings Monday morning after a highway construction company punctured a 6-inch gas line, causing a natural gas leak on the south edge of Baylor's campus.
What started out as a regular Monday morning quickly turned into a little bit of a scare as students received text messages and emails alerting them to a gas leak near the 8th Street parking garage in between the Pizza Hut and 8th Street.
We've had to evacuate some of the buildings, make sure that there's no and shut down any ignition sources so we don't have an explosion or anything like that. We've also shut down the Baylor garage so that way any of the gas blowing from that winds that were blowing in that direction not pocketing in the garage, and so we shut it down for the ignition sources from cars starting and stopping because they're number of things on their vehicles.
Fortunately, no one was hurt in this incident, and students were made aware of the situation through Baylor's emergency contact. However, the closing of the road and the parking garage was inconvenient to some students.
We all got a notification that said gas leak, and luckily our cars are right outside of this garage, so hopefully we can get out and be safe and everyone in the garage can start their car.
So yeah, we're not really sure how long this is going to be like this, which is a little frustrating, but we're hoping they'll work it out, and I have faith that they will.
Getting the email in class was a little concerning.
I have hope that it'll be gone by the end of the day, hopefully. Just waiting for that alert that we can go back and get our cars and leave.
At 12:34 p.m. on Monday, the all-clear signal was sent out from the university. Students were allowed to return to their vehicles and go back to normal. For Lariat TV News, I'm George Schroeder.
Baylor soccer has a hidden trick up their sleeve, a dynamic duo that plays so well together, you'd think they've been teammates for years. But actually, it's quite the opposite. LTVN's Drake Toole caught up with two unsuspecting best friends at Betty Lou May's Field.
Two roads diverged in a wood, and these arch rivals took the one less traveled by. Together. Baylor soccer's Mackenzie Anthony and Gabby Mueller grew up over 300 miles apart, so it's safe to assume they never interacted before coming to Waco, right?
Well, actually, we were rivals.
And not just any rivals.
The biggest rivals, like each game was like always
so intense.
Yeah.
Starting in the eighth grade, Mackenzie and Gabby's club teams went toe-to-toe often, but the prospect of ever being friends just seemed taboo.
My teammates would always ask me, like, oh, you know her? I was like, yeah, a little bit.
We didn't call her Gabby or, like, her number. She's like the girl with the big bun, the little girl with the big bun.
But one unsuspected meeting at Betty Lou May's Field would change everything.
My dad actually pointed her out first. He was like, is that Mackenzie's dad? And I was like, yeah, I think so.
I came over and I was like, hey!
Yeah, and I was like, hi!
And years later, happenstance has turned these two into more than just acquaintances.
Like, I feel like we're more like sisters. Like we, yeah. Like I know she gets annoyed with me.
We definitely get annoyed with me.
Like our little, we have like little quirks. You know, like that's what like all roommates, but like we kind of know each other.
And their unique dynamic has not gone unnoticed by the man that brought them here.
Really two rival clubs they're recruited from. And I even through the recruiting process, that came up quite a bit. Oh man, you've got two, you know, a kid from each of those clubs, you know, how's that going to go? And watching that kind of grow over the last couple of years and their friendship and then them wanting to be roommates was really kind of a cool thing. And then just seeing them pal around in practice is a lot of fun when you think back to where it started.
From rivals to roommates, no one could have seen this story of friendship coming.
Never. I think that was like the biggest thing, was just how like not common this is. Yeah. And then now we're like roomies.
For Lariat TV News, I'm Drake Toll.
Speaking of soccer, we'll hear from Coach Jobson and one of his players to preview their upcoming home match against Oklahoma State.
We'll also get the latest from head football coach Dave Aranda, discussing his first win as a Bear and previewing this weekend's matchup with West Virginia. Stay tuned for sports.
Waking up to another light. No more sorrow and no more night. You're the light, let it shine now. Let it shine now.
After kicking off the Dave Aranda era in dominant fashion last weekend, the Baylor football team is looking to get off to their third straight 2-0 start on Saturday. LTVN heard from Coach Aranda, Jalen Petrie, and RJ Sneed to get the scoop on the Bears' first road game.
After a 47-14 rout of Kansas in their season opener, Coach Dave Aranda and the Bears will head to Morgantown to take on the West Virginia Mountaineers this Saturday.
I think it is going to be very different because when we went 2 years ago, it was packed crowd. We went later on in the season, so it was like cooler temperature. So I think now without fans might be like a weird environment.
Despite the small sample size, West Virginia seems to be a formidable opponent on both sides of the ball. On offense, the Mountaineers will lean on a pretty balanced offensive attack, with the lion's share of the ball carrying duties going to running back Letty Brown, who's averaging an impressive 6.3 yards per carry on the season. Coach Neil Brown's squad also possesses a very solid aerial attack. led by quarterback Jarrett Daigie, who's thrown for a total of 513 yards over two games this season, while averaging 8.3 yards per attempt, putting Daigie among the top 25 in the nation in that category.
Initially, when I watch the film, I see a team that wants to run the ball and wants to, you know, impose their will on the defense, and also a team that likes to take deep shots when you try to crowd in the box. So, you know, I feel like West Virginia is a good matchup, and we're looking forward to compete with them on Saturday.
Defensively, the Mountaineers have been about as stout of a unit as any up to this point in the season. They've allowed only 135 passing yards a game so far, which is good for fifth in the nation. Led by linebacker Vandarius Cowan, the West Virginia defense has also tallied up 5 sacks to go along with 15 tackles for a loss and 2 interceptions.
Defensively, just very disruptive, just very different from some of the previous teams that we've been preparing for. And so they're creative in how they get 4- and 5-man rushes, a lot of twists and stunts and linebacker pressures and that. And so I think they cause a lot of disruption. I like the stuff they do on defense.
The two teams are set for an 11 a.m. kickoff on Saturday morning, with the game being broadcast on your local ABC affiliate. For Lariat TV News, I'm Nate Smith.
After going to overtime for the 3rd straight match last Friday, Baylor soccer suffered their first loss of the season at the hands of Iowa State. Despite the defeat, the Bears saw strong performances from midfielder Chloe Japic and goalkeeper Jennifer Want. Coach Paul Jobson and his squad will have to rebound quickly, though, as they're set to host 4th-ranked Oklahoma State in Waco on Friday. Here's Coach Jobson on how the Bears can upset the Cowgirls.
The numbers, we had a lot of opportunities, and you know, not all those opportunities on the stat sheet were quality opportunities, but we definitely had enough quality opportunities to win the match and put it away before, you know, we got ourselves into trouble at the end of the game. So we made some progress there. I think defensively we continue to grow. So I think every match we're getting better.
We are having a lot of chances, but none have gone the back of the net. And I think the fact that, like, we got one in now, that kind of, I think, lifted us up a little bit. And I think in this game, that gives us some confidence forward, knowing, like, we can put goals in the back of the net.
After the longest wait in the history of the program, Coach Ryan McGuire and the number 2 volleyball team in the nation are finally set to get back on the court in the Farrell Center. The Bears opened up their season by splitting their first 2 matches with Kansas a week ago. Now they'll look to win 2 in a row this Friday as they play host to a familiar foe.
The Bears are finally home. After splitting last weekend's season opening series with Kansas, Coach Ryan McGuire and his team will get the chance to bounce back from last weekend's series and go for a 3rd straight sweep of rival TCU.
I think it was really big to come back Saturday night and get the sweep. I feel like we were able to make quick adjustments during the game, and we were really intentional with what we did.
So far, the Bears have been solid both offensively and defensively. Baylor is coming off of a 45-kill performance, with 3 players, Lauren Harrison, Kara McGee, and Yasiana Presley, all going for double-digit kills. They also held Kansas to a 112 overall hitting percentage while tallying up 8 blocks throughout the match. Although the Horned Frogs have yet to play a match this season, the squad won't be a complete mystery to Coach McGuire and company. TCU is returning 6 of their 7 starters from last year, as well as 76% of all of their kills from last year's squad.
It is a lot like the Kansas match last week, except they have more information on us than even Kansas did. TCU a little less as far as new faces. They have some that you know, we'll just have to do our homework on still and see. But, you know, I think we can anticipate who's returning and what positions they're playing and look at film from what they are doing.
The rivals are set to face off on both Friday and Saturday at 5 p.m., with Friday's match being broadcast on ESPNU. For Lariat TV News, I'm Nate Smith.
The cross-country team came away from their first meet victorious, sweeping Abilene Christian University off of their feet. The Bears won decisively, with Connor Laktasic and Celia Holmes leading the way, both achieving personal best times and winning their respective races. The team is heading to Stillwater Saturday to compete in Oklahoma State's Cowboy Jamboree.
First of all, just a great matchup for us. ACU is a good team, and you know they're kind of right within our wheelhouse on both sides. So like we were going to have to run well to do well, right? It wasn't just going to be a gimme. This weekend, actually, we'll race again in Stillwater at the Oklahoma State course. The competition level is going to ramp up, and so we're going to really find out kind of what we're made of. And I hope we react the same way to where we did in Abilene. It's a much different course. ACU, pancake flat, really the only enemy out there was the mosquitoes. This one, we're going to have our hands full because it, you know, a lot of people say Oklahoma's flat, but they found some hills and they're going to wear us out, basically.
Baylor Women's Golf opened up their season with a statement victory in last weekend's Schooner Classic in Norman. The Bears claimed an unprecedented 31-stroke victory in the tournament, the largest margin of victory in school history. Their 7-under-par team total for 3 rounds was also a school record. The tournament field included all 10 Big 12 teams, making Baylor an early favorite to win the conference. They're back on the course next week at the Betsy Rawls Invitational in Austin.
From a murder investigation to a COVID vaccine, that's all for this week's newscast.
Be sure to watch us on BaylorLariat.com, the Waco City Channel, or catch us every Friday in the Lariat's Morning Buzz.
Thanks for watching Lariat TV News. Tune in next Friday for more student-focused content about Baylor, for Baylor.